Tim Ryan. This is my beautiful better half.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Jimenez. We are so excited today to have on a beautiful powerhouse guest.
And who would that be?
That would be my girlfriend, our friend, Brandy Ledford.
Brandy Ledford. Brandy, how are you?
Hi, I'm so happy to be here.
Thank you for coming on the show today, Brandy.
My pleasure.
Admire you. We love you. We miss seeing you. We haven't seen you in a long time because this crazy COVID world.
Not only are you our friend, my girlfriend, somebody who has a remarkable story, but you're an actress, a model, a mom, a wife. You've overcome a lot of adversities, and I'm so excited for you to be here to talk about all this stuff.
I'm so excited to wear clothes and makeup. And hair.
I know, right? So I'm wearing socks. I just want to let you know and like cut off.
I am not wearing socks, but I am so happy to see you guys. I miss you. I miss everything. And I'm just thrilled and honored that you asked me to be part of your show. Congratulations on your huge show.
Thank you.
Well, we only have huge guests on such as yourself. So let's get right in it. I mean, you have a career that spans over 30 years.
God, I'm old. Yes.
You're wise.
You're not
old. You are
old.
Wise. You're gorgeous. You're beautiful. You're not old.
But it's true. I have had a career for 30 years, the same career for 30 years. And yes, I...
Where did it start?
Well, you're from Denver, right?
I'm from LA. I was born in Denver, but when we were two, we moved to Redondo Beach. So I don't think you can say you're from a place just because you were born there, because my... growing up, everything that's ingrained in me is from growing up in Redondo Beach. And then as a teenager, coming out to LA and West Hollywood and Hollywood, and just being a real beach girl, turned to LA, city girl. When I was 18, I moved straight to LA and started working. I was modeling and, I modeled for a while and I got pretty successful in that field. And then I realized that it wasn't what I wanted to do. It wasn't sitting right with me, the kind of modeling I was doing. I started having to ask myself, how is this making me feel? And I wasn't really proud of it. You know, I didn't really do anything to get the way that I look. I didn't work out. I didn't, I was just modeling. And I really, all my life, since I was 11 years old, wanted to be an actress. And so I took a chance and I quit modeling and I started studying acting. And I just started studying and working really hard and auditioning my little butt off and just putting one foot in front of the other and meeting people and networking. And eventually I got a really great job and then I just kept working and working. And
you were very similar.
Well, we are. And yet, I love, we all have individual stories, because for me, when I got into, I got discovered, and then I, was working with Bruce Weber and I was shooting all these things. And then one of the things I did was a movie, and modeling was just something that it came my way, but I really didn't, I wanted to end modeling before it ended me. Right. And it sounds kind of that's what you were saying. But I remember when I started acting, I studied for a long time. Like you did, I stopped modeling, I was studying. And I took it very seriously. And my, first movie as an actress, although I had already done a movie, I knew being in front of the camera was something I loved doing. But I knew, it was so funny, I had this huge manager, and he would tell me, I'd go on these huge auditions, and he'd be like, do not tell one person that you are a model. I'm like, what? How do I not say I'm 5'10"? I was in Cars with magazine. How do I not say I'm a model? He's like, they won't take you seriously. And being a woman that was a model, did that happen for you? Or was that a problem trying to break through?
So I actually also had a really incredible manager, Connie Tavel. She was an amazing manager. And she was really careful with my image. She wanted to protect me and make sure that I was not being, exploited in the wrong way. But I watched your TED Talk, Miss Jennifer, and I could not believe how much I related to so much, especially, the painful, ugly truth, truthful side of this business, and how it might look on the outside, but how it would actually feel on the inside. And So that's what I mean about when I was modeling. I had this great opportunity and I was traveling around the world and I was, you know, I guess living a dream, but it wasn't my dream. And so when I decided to get into acting, I did have great advice, and it was, don't use your modeling career as a stepping stone. Now, you have to understand, though, I was doing nude modeling, and it was great advice. I never used it to get in any door. It was never on my resume. I never spoke about it. We didn't have the internet then, so it wasn't common knowledge, you know. After a month or a few months would pass, nobody would even know. And so I really just got by working really hard, and I have a really, really, to this day, really strong, strict work ethic. And of course, you know, I think a lot of luck and connections and the right timing plays a lot into it. But yeah, I never used my modeling career, but that doesn't mean to say that I didn't use, you know, what I had to offer to get into the door. My breakthrough came from using my looks and my sex appeal to get all those little fun roles. I'm Married with Children, and you know that.
What was the first TV show as an extra? What was the first thing on camera you actually did?
In acting, and God, that's such a good question. I don't know why I don't know the answer. You know, I want to say it was Demolition Man. Yeah, I got my SAG card. I may have done some non-union stuff that's out there lurking around somewhere. you can't work until you get a SAG card, but you can't get a SAG card until you work. And so I ended up auditioning for and getting this really small, fun role in Demolition Man, and that got me my SAG card. And I always say that's my very first film because of that. But I also had done, I would say it was Married with Children as well, at that around the same time. There was just this block of time where I
Demolition
was just
Man
working.
Married with Children. But you know what? Did you feel, Brandy, that after Demolition Man, it really opened up doors to other opportunities? I mean, did it just kind of keep progressing?
Yes, and you know why? Not because so many people knew who I was from that movie, but because it was on my resume, right? So at that time, your resume really mattered. And the amount of, so Warner Brothers hires you, and you get a huge movie. People are going to look at you more. They're going to trust you. They're going to, you know, want to see you and get you in the door. But I always, and I said it then, and I say it now, anything can get you in the door, but you need to have what it takes to stay in the door. And I knew that early on, and I did not use exterior qualities only. I knew I had to be a trained actress. I knew I had to be smart. I knew I had to start learning about current events. You know, I was in my 20s. I was so young. And I don't even think 20-year-olds now understand, you know, news and current events. And like the way that everyone was talking about situations, and I didn't know. I mean, I knew who the president was at the time, but I didn't know world events. And I thought, well, I need to start getting full, you know, whole. I need to get a lot of different qualities, not just looks and not just sex appeal. I wanted to be well-rounded. And so I started reading the newspapers, and actually I liked it. It might have been the catalyst for me being so informed today. But back then, I just wanted to be something and seen for more than just what it looks like. I look like on
the outside. What a concept to read a newspaper.
No, but like, understand, like everything that you're saying, like I so understand, because first and foremost, this is like not underplay the fact that you did nude modeling. That stuff is hard. Like that shit's hard, and I know that for a fact. So like that was hard. That is like an art form in itself. But like to be taken seriously, like my voice didn't matter. At least that's what I thought in my head. And I needed to be educated, right? Even though I spoke language, 40 languages, I traveled the world, you traveled the world, but we needed to be more educated. Like we have more to prove, I feel like, than the average person coming into acting, you know? And you know, you've really created something and broke barriers for so many people. And yet there's something else that you were struggling with your whole entire life, you know, which is you're a woman in recovery today and your sobriety. Like, when did that start in the midst of all this? You need to be intelligent, you need to be this, and you're trying to break through doors and all this stuff. And then are you struggling at that time? Like, when did your addiction or alcoholism start?
Well, I think, you know, as you know, we're born alcoholics. So I started drinking really young and early and got in a lot of trouble in my early years of high school, and had basically just partied a lot since I was about 16, 14, 11, if I'm being honest, but really, really, you know.
So I mean, at that age, sorry to cut you off, and then you're like triumphing in this entertainment world at the same time.
But I mean, I think you see that a lot, right? I think you see that with a lot of actors and a lot of musicians and celebrities. And it's like I'm saying, there's this, I think it actually plays into this facade that we're trying to keep up and trying to pretend and trying to act like we're a certain thing, and way too afraid to say I'm in trouble, I need help, or I'm bleeding, or I'm suffering. And I was dealing with eating disorders and alcoholism and hardcore drug addiction.
Go ahead, Brandy.
You said go ahead and then well, you know, sorry, we're going to bicker during this
part too. I'm picturing Jennifer sharing stories when you two, how long have you guys known each other?
Well, we've known each other through the years, and then we got reintroduced, I think, through Triana, right? Or
it was through Jason and Hillary.
It was.
Well, yeah. Okay. But I go back to Jennifer's stories of when she did blow and getting into acting, but the parties at the Playboy Mansion and this. Were you in that whole world of the parties of this and just trying to get home and be by yourself and self-medicating, or did you have a good team around you? I mean, what was your world like in that?
I definitely did not have a good team around me, and I didn't have... I was around a lot of other playmates and models who were definitely partying the way I was partying. And the actresses that I ended up meeting in acting class, I was still bulimic, I was still using drugs and alcohol. They were not using or drinking, using drugs or drinking. And as far as I knew, they weren't really, having any eating disorders or these things that you and I typically understand, Jen. But I didn't get that in my circle in the acting circle, but I was still using. So I was doing it alone. So I was really isolated. And yeah, and I didn't know how to ask for help. My best friend to this day, actually, we were in acting class together when I was 23, and she found out that I was suffering and really just kicked my butt and got me into Thaline's treatment center. At Cedars-Sinai, an outpatient clinic. And it was the first time they do a questionnaire, and it was the first time I really answered questions honestly and was able to really understand a little bit more about some trauma and some an addiction and eating disorders. And when I was 24, I stopped.
This happened at 24?
That was at 22, 23. And when I was 24, I got a hold of my eating disorder, and I started eating and living healthy again in that way. And I never got back to that. But I was still really addicted to drugs and I couldn't stop drinking. So I then found out, and I was working. So now I'm working, I'm in movies, I'm doing TV, and I'm running around and I'm partying. And yes, Tim, I was definitely like, I just want to go home. And then I'd get home and I'd be so, it was a miracle I made it home. I mean, I lived in Malibu at the time, and I would drive in the rain and on PCH, and I was a mess. And it's by the grace of God, I didn't die. I don't know. It's a miracle that I'm sitting here. A lot of the pain and the danger I put myself through along the years. And then when I was 25, I got pregnant with my older child. And when I found out I was pregnant, I was on a show. I was on a TV series when I found out I got pregnant. Both kids, I was on a TV show and I found out I got pregnant, by the way. I mean, I guess that's an actor's life. But anyway, and I quit. Of course, I said, I'm not drinking. I'm going to stop doing coke. And I never did drugs. I never did hard drugs again. And I stayed clean and sober for a number of years after Christian was born. And then I I didn't really have a program of recovery. I didn't have a sponsor. I didn't have people I was talking to. I had people now in my life, but I wasn't talking to them. And I think that's the biggest mistake. And now I've learned about discernment. I've learned how to ask for help. I've learned how to ask for advice. I've learned how to say yes. And I've learned how to say no. And
it's right there. That's one word Jennifer taught me is no, I can't do that. And because I look at the three of us here, we're very caring and giving people. I'd say we're all probably people pleasers in some way, shape, or form. But hearing you, it trembles me inside, hearing you talk about so many of the same pains and suffering, the eating disorders, the loneliness, the addiction that my wife went through. And I'm just grateful you're where you're at today and that you're open and you talk about this, because if this helps one person that's here that hears this, that's all that matters. Yeah. That's it.
That's right. And I figured that out a while ago. I figured out that I don't want my experience to go to waste.
Yeah.
What was it for? Mm-hmm. What was my experience for? Why did I hurt myself and others so deeply if I can't now be redeemed and try to help others? And so in terms of being an open book, I'm really an open book. There's just nothing off limits. I'll talk about anything because I want to be helpful, because I spent a life being dishonest. I want to be honest. I want to be truthful. I have nothing to hide. Now I really want to be seen.
Yeah.
Well, I have nothing to hide.
I mean, I hear you and I'm like, wow, I hear you and I see you. And I know that, like, I'm just, you even talking about, like, the thing that's hit me so hard right now is you driving in the rain and just wanting to get home and going being alone and like wanting to go back to that world because you don't know how to function in this world, right? So like, I'm just so full of how I see it is like, I just resonate. And I know that somebody out there right now is so resonating with you because you're like having to prove so much more and yet you can't even be in your own presence, like in your own moment, in your own, like, I'm just here and I'm intelligent. Like, we have to prove that we're intelligent. Like, that right there is like mind blowing to me because I get it. I get it. I'm there. I'm you. You are me, you know? And yet, like, you're so freaking successful. And like, you're doing TV series, you're doing movies, you're doing this. Like, you're being a mom, you're being a wife. Like, and you're doing all these things. And like, you're in this disease.
Yeah, right. I'll tell you what. That drives me insane to hear you say that. It makes me want to, like, I'm like, just today, just for today, like, all I have to do is I pray, I meditate, I read some devotionals and AA literature, you know, 12-step literature. I do some 12-step meetings. I'm honest. I do inventory. I spend a lot of time with my higher power, and that's just for today.
Because I spend a lot of time with my higher power too.
But I see it in you. I see the serenity, you the serene, and like
a peace.
I mean,
glow.
And to know you, like, your movements are so present and calm and like blissful and beautiful. You know, and that's me being with you at lunch. You know what I mean? I remember that so quickly. Like, you know, because we all watch each other. We all observe and absorb each other, and I remember that so vividly. But yet there's that, and then you're acting, and then you got sober, and then you didn't work a program, and then what happened?
Oh, then I went crazy. I spiraled really, really quickly. I had the idea that I could drink again. I felt this time like a lady. You know, I was in my 20s when I was crazy. And I was so young when I stopped, and now my life is so together. I have this career and these children, and I'm older, and I can drink like a lady. And I just went immediately.
How quick? How quick did that, from picking up that drink, did that rocket ship crash? And
I mean, really a matter of days, no joke. Because, you know, you drink like a lady by having maybe half a glass of wine at dinner. I was chugging vodka and hiding it in my freezer. So right away. And
like the normal people do.
Yeah. Like a lady, yeah. I mean, and then I was, you know, getting access to prescription medication to intensify the effect. And so it was not a long time after I decided to pick up again. And I just I didn't know who I was. I wasn't myself. I wasn't open. I wasn't clear. I don't even remember much of it. I hurt my family incredibly. My health, my body was crap, but I did a lot of damage. And
I want to ask you a question, Brandy. When that was going on, did your friends and people know, did they say anything, or did they just accept it and kind of brush it off?
Nobody knew. I hit it.
You
hit it.
So my dearest friends, nobody knew. Like, they would be like, she's just knows how to tap in. I'd be like, yeah. And I'm the girl that would put, water. It's water. It's really vodka. Or like, wine bottles with, sorry, babe, an ex back in the day. And I'd fill it with grape juice and like try to be like, fill it up and then hide it again. And act like it was brand new. I was like, I didn't drink it. But like, nobody knew.
No, because you'll go to any extent to get that high, to get that drunk, to just feed that dragon. It's not even about the way you're going to feel, because later you're going to feel sick and disgusting and regretful. It's just becomes, it gets ahead of you, right? And so I made sure nobody knew. I was hiding it. And that is the thing I can say about honesty is you're only as sick as your secrets.
Amen.
And so because I had this huge secret and I was isolating, I started making really bad decisions that I could have asked people if I should maybe do or not do. And since I wasn't asking, I was sort of justifying it. I was doing these things, but I was justifying it. And so eventually I led people to think that I could drink a glass of wine now, because I couldn't handle a dinner party or any of these events we go to without drinking, right? And so I made them believe that I was only having the one glass or two. Meanwhile, I'd already been, loaded before we even left the house, and they didn't know. And so it was kind of a shock to them when I OD'd, to say the least. And
I love the way you said it.
Kind of a shock when I OD'd.
You said it so sweet. Like, I love that you said it.
I mean, and people that are listening to this or watching this, unless you're in recovery, you can't understand
why we're not making fun of it.
Why we're laughing, but I mean,
and the sad truth is many people don't get out to laugh about it.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I was in a hospital hooked up and handcuffed to a gurney because I was also belligerent. But I'm so grateful for that event that last night, because I still wasn't willing. You have to understand, I was in a bad place. And now my best friends and my closest circle of loved ones were actually in the hospital with me and or on FaceTime, and they were surrounding me. They were so worried about me because I was so sick, and I still wasn't willing that night. They were begging me to go to rehab, and they were begging me to tell them what was going on. And I was still holding on to this addiction, and it had a grip on me. Mm. And out of the blue, I just looked at my mom and I said, fine, I'll go to rehab. And I said, I'll do it, but I have conditions.
We always have our conditions.
I love
I'm
when
going
I hear
for me. 5 days.
Yeah. That's my line, yeah.
But I ended up going for 98 days. And I saved my life. God saved my life. That treatment program was incredible. I learned about alcoholism. I didn't know what it was. We just drink. We just do drugs. We just party. We just get access. We just get addicted. I learned about, I learned about so much. I learned about forgiveness. I learned how to reparent myself. I learned how to ask for forgiveness from my older son who I'd, hurt deeply. I learned how to accept his forgiveness. I learned how to be the woman that I'm proud to be today. Not always. It's progress, right? Not perfection. And I definitely have a long way to go.
We have moments. My sponsor told me I can call them moments. Like when I have
moments.
And boy, do I have a lot of moments. But
I seem to have a lot of moments.
Yeah, I think, you know what? some days it's really fucking hard to wake up and be in my shoes. Like, I wake up and I'm like, I'm the biggest fucking piece of shit that exists out there. And I don't feel good about myself. And shit comes up. And then other days, I float, levitate. I'm like, you know. But it's a process. It's baby steps sometimes.
But Jennifer, you communicate, and obviously Brandy does, and you have your core group, and something you tell on yourself. Sometimes she blows up like a rocket ship, but she tells on herself, and she doesn't keep things in to put her in a worse situation or into a deep depression or whatever it is, because we have those tools and we have those foundations today. And I mean, you are a glowing light.
Yeah.
I'm blessed that God put you into my life. I call you a friend, that I have Jennifer, that our circles have intertwined, because this is just the beginning on where this is going to go and what's going to happen. But as long as we keep getting up and doing the next right thing, it's pretty badass. You know, recovery does not suck.
No, it doesn't. It feels impossible for some people, though, you know, and for you hearing the story about like your friends and your family, and you didn't want to get so like, I well, not want it either. I didn't.
That's right.
Yeah.
And the reason I said I'm grateful for that particular part of that night is because I remember now, and I'll never forget it. And I share about it when I speak in meetings and I speak to people and I, you know, do my thing, because I was at the bottom and was still not willing. And so today, whatever I'm doing, whether it's like you said, you know, you get moments and you take off, right? I have learned to not self-degrade, but I still will beat myself up, and I will still make mistakes and then get real hard on myself about that. And I just have to remember, all I have to do is be willing. That's it. It just has to be, and then trust that God's going to take the rest of it. So if I was speaking to a newcomer or a person who didn't want to get sober or wanted to get sober but didn't know how and was still fighting that addiction, I would really talk about, first of all, you know, how honesty, openness, and willingness. But that willingness is key for me, because that's when you have true faith.
Yeah.
It's when you have like, I'm just willing. I don't know what. I don't know what I need. I don't know what, how. I'm willing for something to be different. And and sometimes when I don't even have those words, and I just said this to a recent newcomer, you know, someone newly sober or just trying to come sober, I said, just do this. Can you see my hands?
Yeah.
My whole life is zooming. I can't figure this out. Okay. So if you just do this, and you're either asking God to fill it up or you're asking him to take it away.
I like that.
That's beautiful.
Good stuff. I want to flip the script.
Wait here. A minute.
No, I'm flipping.
No. Hold on. We're not flipping yet. So you start getting sober, right? Like, you start your recovery journey. Was it difficult for you? What was your most challenging thing in the first, you know, 4 or 5 years or so?
Well, of this sobriety, this turn around. So I ended up with a miracle baby, and I got pregnant. My husband and I were in a bad spot when I went to rehab. Understatement. And God bless him. And we had a lot to work on, and so we spent a lot of time working on our marriage. But at the same time, I fell pregnant 3 days after I got out of rehab.
Wow.
Yeah, which is a huge blessing, because I was 43 and it was a miracle. And we had tried before, and I just the state of, I was having miscarriages prior, devastating. And so the hardest thing for me the first year was getting pregnant and not knowing if I was going to have the baby, because I had late term miscarriages that were devastating and brutal. I, during that time, wanted prescription pain pills because I was in so much pain.
Sure.
So scared. And I was just like, I was just so nervous and scared all the time. Having the baby, which is always challenging in the best of days, which was beautiful too. It was just, he's the sweetest, most loving angel. But also having a baby and going through new sobriety and repairing a marriage. And then I had a stroke. I had the loop thing happens to me. It happens when you're, you know, young and thin and healthy and you do yoga. And I was doing hot yoga and I overextended my neck and my carotid artery dissected. And
wow.
I was rushed to the hospital. I was in the ICU. So I was pumped full of Dilaudid and pain medication. You know, that was a necessity. But when I got out of the hospital and when I was on my road to recovery from that, it was a year of me craving every day because I was in severe pain with my neck. Wow. But not severe enough that a Tylenol or some Advil couldn't take it away. But this addict was like, no, I need Percocet. I can, don't give me Tylenol.
Mm-hmm.
And that was really, really hard. And I never took the pain pills. I never got a prescription from them. I just knew, right? So I was constantly telling my sponsor and my sober sisters and AA, you know, my 12-step meetings. I was just saying, like, I'm craving this and I need help from this addiction because I know for a fact. And look, I'm not against, you know, if you need medication, if it's prescribed because you've had surgery, there's an actual thing, right? Like, this is just the truth for me was I knew, so talk about honesty, I knew a Tylenol would take it away, right? Maybe three Tylenol, but that would take it away, the pain. And I knew it was fear, and I knew it was anxiety, and I worked through that sober and clean, and I never once took a pain pill, and then the pain went away.
I mean, that was like your first year of sobriety. What did you think about every day?
Using and dying. That's all I thought about. I always say I turn them blue in the face because I'm like, I just want to die. I want to use. I want to die. I want to use. Because I didn't have any game left in me. I didn't have, I had a gift of desperation, but like, I didn't know how to not do this. And I suffer from like back problems. Like right now he's been seeing me like on the floor, like roll, like in pain. And, you know, I could take some medication, but I don't, you know, and yet like I know Advil or ibuprofen 800, but I gotta be careful because I have other illnesses. So like underlining this, so my kidneys need to be good, you know? And so I can't just pop them all day or like four a day or anything. Ibuprofen. I have to be very cautious. And I get it. Like, that is so freaking powerful right now. Like, I'm blown away by the story. I did not know this. So.
And thank you for sharing that and being transparent and honest. No, we're flipping the script now because we could have recovery talk all day. I want to talk.
Well, the marriage has been repaired.
Just
let people know.
Good. That is absolutely awesome. Kids are healthy. You're healthy. I want to talk about after Demolition Man. What did you end up what was your role that really catapulted you? What was it in?
You know, I would say that there was a series of sci-fi shows that I did, and the sci-fi fans are the best. You know, of course, I was in Baywatch, and I was on Modern Family, and all these shows that are exciting, and everybody knows about them, but I have to tell you, the sci-fi crowd is so dedicated and loyal, and they're just a bunch of smart nerds who suspend their disbelief that they thought that I could be an android, this most powerful woman being in the world, you know. And it was a Gene Roddenberry show called Andromeda that really, to me, it was one of my favorite roles to play, and it was one of the shows that really, if you want to say, catapulted. It really
helps. That's now open the door for all the Comic-Cons you get to go to.
That's right, yeah. The sci-fi really does. Because there were some shows before that that I worked for years on, you know, and I was always a working actress, but shows that a lot of people didn't know. But it was fine, you know, it was just this wonderful career. I never not worked. And then I did The Invisible Man, which was a really very popular sci-fi show on Sci-Fi Network. Yeah, so the sci-fi is just, it's not even that it's my genre to watch. It's just that they are such great storylines. They're always super fun to play and the fans are the very best. But you know, I mean, there's always Baywatch. So yes, that was it. But I was in that spell, that period of time when I was dry and sort of not drinking or using drugs, but also not in a program of recovery. So I was a workaholic and I was married to my older son's father. and we were going through a thing, and I was just like making crazy, terrible decisions. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I decided, not that this is such a bad thing, but I didn't want to be one of the Baywatch girls. I was a serious actress, and I was the athlete on the show, and I was not going to use my sex appeal on this show. And kind of in hindsight, that was a mistake because I had it. I didn't.
Use it. You got it. Use it.
I'm going to be the smart one.
That's so funny because
on Baywatch.
I know, right? I mean, like, I tell Tim about some of the movies, like, I passed by on, and I'm like, I'm an actress. Like, now I'm like, you want me to do a hemorrhoid commercial? Oh, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, the stories Jennifer tells me on the opportunity she has. No, oh, I didn't do that, or I'm a mess. It's like, are you nuts?
Thank you.
You look upset with a music video with who?
Jay-Z, and I was getting paid. I didn't want to be stereotyped saying that I was a girl. I was a Latin girl. It was like degrading to me. Like, I'm like, who the fuck does that? Like, right?
I know.
Girl video. Like, I mean, it's just like, and I was acting though, but I was acting. I just needed to be super cool. Like,
I know.
What? Like, and now I'm like, oh.
But look, it could have worked, right? It could have worked. It could have been Charlize Theron. I could have done that. I could have got to, but you know.
Well, you know, what's interesting is it was probably 8 months ago now, Jen comes to me and she says, Tim, I've got to tell you something. I want to start acting again. I said, go ahead.
Yeah, you know,
we're speaking and doing this. And she got two movies, then a third, then a pilot. She actually gets me a lead in the pilot. I've never done this in my life. They give me a lead and we fly back from Texas on a Tuesday. We're supposed to film the pilot Friday, and Thursday everything in LA gets shut down. How is it, I mean everything, and how has it affected you? Did you have any things teed up to be filming, movies? How has it affected you, and where are you at right now?
Well, it affected me work-wise. We were in the middle of shooting our documentary, the Baywatch documentary, and I was due to film, I think the week after everything shut down. And we were still sort of scrambling, like, well, maybe we can do this, maybe we can, you know, and we couldn't, and we still haven't. We've shot some stuff. We shot some long-distance car driving intro stuff, but we never got to do my final interview. We haven't. And they're just now getting back to filming safely. But that was definitely like a shock. It affected, I was really terrified. I think I was like most people I have spoken to or heard from, I was in a real state of panic. And it was, it's when I upped up my recovery work. I mean, I probably the month of March, April, and May spent more time working in my recovery program than I did the entire 8 years of my sobriety.
What a blessing for us, though, that people don't understand. When we speak to parents and kids or a community event, I'll be like, look, if everybody worked a 12-step-based program, even if you're an alcoholic or not, it would be a much better society.
Yeah. And I know.
Do for Alcoholics Anonymous and 12 steps. Because we have something that the other people don't understand. And look at what it did for you. It got you to dig deeper, and God works in weird ways, but the fear of COVID and everything shut down, I mean, it flipped. We can't go to lunch and just hang out, and now maybe we can, but it shut everything because we were supposed to have lunch again and we couldn't.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. But, you know, mostly it was I was so worried for our children. You know, my younger son is starting first grade and he's in kindergarten, and now he's home for who knows how long. And I was just terrified for the kids, and I was really, really worried about school, and I was really worried about him, and I was just all up in my head of worry and just all that panic. And that's when I really had to tune into one day at a time, and just, I have to do this sometimes 1 hour at a time. I was having insane panic attacks around this whole thing. And the thing is a lot of people I know, and I said that all the time, Tim, I said, I wish everyone had a 12-step program because I'm gonna get through this way. And sure enough, I did. And the people that I know who were sort of handling it a little bit better in the beginning, they were like, okay, so this is okay. I learned a lot about people's coping skills. So my coping skills, I just feel it immediately, right? I know, I'm so feeling, I feel it. And then I'm okay with feeling it, so I just go into it. lot of people are like, have a different coping skill. So maybe 2-3 months later, I'm now jamming with this homeschool. I'm jamming with staying home. I got Zoom. I got the whole thing. I'm fine. I have like, I'm having groceries delivered. I got the cute masks. I'm in. I know it works. I'm getting tested. I'm like, fine.
That's her.
Dude, I spent a lot of time shopping for masks.
You go to the airport.
You asked me about a mask. You're like,
I loved your mask. No, I was obsessed. I'm still, I don't go anywhere to wear a mask, but I can't stop buying these masks.
We're at the airport the other day, flying from St. Louis to LA, and Jen goes, hold on, here's your new mask. And mine is a dog face with the tongue hanging out, and hers is a cat. I'm like,
Oh my God. And when you guys got COVID, and then I have another set of friends who got it, and another friend who got, and they got it really bad, and I was really worried and so scared for y'all and so scared for, it's just this unknown. And then the things you know were scary, and the whole thing was just, I'm happy that I was able to get to a place. And I think we're all in a different place with it now, but the friends of mine who were not struggling in the beginning were really struggling 3-4 months later. And I was able to be there for them, and I was able to be in a different kind of equilibrium with it. And so that was, that's kind of the joy. I watched that trajectory and I see, what did it do for me? It taught me a lot about myself. It taught me a lot about, okay, I'm going to stay home now with my son all day, every day.
All right.
And like I said, which has also been a blessing, and I have found a bunch of silver linings. But also, I've learned to ask for help. I'm not without being able to ask for help, right? And set some boundaries with my son. That was a big thing. And take care of myself. It's to say, like, it's okay to take care of myself during this time, because if I don't, mama's gonna go out and we can't have that.
I do know, because it's funny, like I kept saying to him, and he doesn't get, he's a dude, he's just 100% dude, right? Like,
he's all man. Tim,
yeah, all man.
Ryan is all man.
I'm like, I haven't had my nails done, like these are like Luan's, right? Like, yeah. And I'm loving to like do this, yeah. When I get like this, but like my toes, I haven't done my toes, I finally got my toes done the other day, but like it was 7 months I was doing them, right? I'm doing like hair color, like, I mean, it's a, like the things that would just
the get simple me things that you're,
and it's not for luxury, it's not for like, I like to go to the spa, get the, like, it's for work, right? Like, I wasn't even doing that for work. Like,
but you know what? It's your hour, 2 hours away from me with the girls, whatever, and just doing your thing.
Yeah, I mean, it was, I mean, I understand having to dig deep. Like, I've had to dig deep therapy, thank God. My girls that, like, I talked to, like, the Tara Connors of the world, you know, that we're friends with, we're both friends with, like, just like,
I love Tara.
So much, and telling them myself, like, yeah, and also realizing that this, we're gonna get through this, exactly what you're talking about. We're gonna get through this, and you know, keeping a healthy balance too with my relationship. I'm sure you've had to do that too.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what about self-care. Of course, you know, we get our hair done, we get our nails. This is part of self-care, and it's not superficial. If you spend so much time working on your inner life, you know, it just comes natural that you want to work on your outer life. But I definitely feel like I'm stronger now. And because of that, I'm taking self-care seriously. It's really important right now. It's so important, even if it's just a bath, you know, for an hour, just to like have some time to yourself. I think it's really important.
I agree.
It's. I was talking with my mom this morning, and my 5-year-old had picture day. And I had made a comment, and she said, Tim, you know, when we grew up and you guys grew up as kids, you just went, you took your picture, we provided food, you know, we didn't worry about all those other things. But she said, looking at you now, the way you look, the way you dress, I just want to thank Jennifer, because she's really turned you into a much better looking person. But, you know, I was talking to someone this morning, and I said, you know what, it's nice to put on a nice watch, a sport coat, a dress shirt, look well for my wife. We went to Dantana's for dinner Saturday night for my
love party. Dantana's.
first time in a restaurant in LA in over 8 months.
Yeah, but you know, I was talking to my therapist. I still do therapy too, but I was telling him, I said, you don't know how proud I was to be able to walk into a restaurant with my best friend and how beautiful my wife looked, and our table was a little ticked because you're eating outside, but it was just an amazing experience. And yeah, those are the things that we need for ourselves. And you know, I like to go eat a meal today because I was always jacked on cocaine or heroin or booze. I ate a honey bun or a candy bar, you know? So we're gonna have to go do that. What else? We've got 5 more minutes left here. What else do you have in the works? Anything? What else are you doing?
Well, so the Baywatch documentary will come out eventually. And I'll let y'all know when that happens. And I'm working, I'm getting a little involved in politics right now. I mean, no, don't get excited.
I've seen that. I've seen that. I love that.
Yeah, I'm working with, I'm working on, you know, just trying to hold the House and flip the Senate. And I'm really honored to be working with Remedy Pack, just helping, you know, as much as I can. There's, it's remedypack.com. And I'm just, I'm really impressed by the work they're doing. To help candidates flip the Senate and keep the House. I think it's really important, especially now more than ever.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I
love that though. I keep seeing your posts and stuff and getting out there and vote or mail in, but I've been seeing your posts a lot and I'm so happy you're doing that because we
I learned, thank you for saying that. I really appreciate that because there's a lot of stuff I didn't know, right? So why should I be interested in a Senate race in a state that I don't live in? And it just informs me to get interested. Then I become more informed, then I can be more helpful and I can donate and I can, like we said, I don't want my experience to be wasted. So if right now I have the time and I have the experience and I have the ability and I have the desire to help in any way I can, I like to say this is not my quote, but I love the quote. I want to do all the good I can for all the people I can whenever I can. And so remedypack.com right now is where it's at for me. And then I'm also on the board of a recovery and trauma foundation called the Red Songbird Foundation. It's basically a dream come true for me to be on a board of a foundation because it's so special to be able to give back and to see what they're doing. It's just mind blowing. You know, they're really focused on prevention and education and solution for people who have dealt with trauma and addictions and mental health issues. And it's just absolutely beautiful to watch Hillary and Jason.
It is, and you know, people don't, I, two things. I go back to when you said you read the newspaper to learn more, and you're now taking your knowledge to understand our government. I don't care what party you support, but it's something you believe in, and that's all that matters, and go do it the best you can.
Yeah.
We need more people like you. We need women that are strong and proud and have a voice and, you know, can make a difference. And if you feel fulfilled in here, that's all that matters. And to be on the board of a nonprofit, Jennifer and I are both on our Amanda Recovery Foundation board, which I started.
Hillary is amazing.
Yeah, Hillary's doing great things. Jason Waller, we love Jason. Yeah. He's doing some amazing things. And
you guys collaborating is amazing. I'm so excited about this. I mean, it is a great, great cause.
It really
and
is.
And we can do to support you, please let us know. And if you guys have events coming up, we can plug them and talk about them. And
I want you to know, I'm speaking on behalf of everyone watching and women that I know you and men that know you. You are a strong voice. You are an important voice. You are a badass warrior for us in recovery and us women. You know, you have really taken it from where you came from to where you are right now, like out of this world. And I love you. I love you. And I honor you. So thank you.
That means so much to me. That means so much to me, Jen. Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you so much. You're incredible.
We love you.
Brandy, we want to thank you for coming on the Tim and Jen show. We absolutely will have you back. We want to see you soon. And we are just so grateful that you are a voice for the voiceless. that you're doing everything you're doing, and we love you, and we want you to have an amazing day.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I will now.
Thank you. All right. Thank you so much, Brandy.
We love you.
Love you.
Now, glutathione is a big word, but it's the body's own master antioxidant. So it's a scavenger for free radicals, for bacteria, and what's relevant now, viruses.
We'll call you, Brandy.
Thank you.
Is new to the marketplace. There's no other product on the market that has the ingredient NACET.
And basically, NACET increases the production of that glutathione that is in our body already to strengthen and enhance our immune system and keep it strong. Elevated sense of well-being. Supports muscle strength and endurance. Cognitive function. Powerful liver support. Energy helps blood sugar regulation, superior bioavailability of key ingredients.
One of your best defenses against COVID is a strong immune system. Taking GSH Plus as a daily supplement does all that. Now we have the product out on the market.